I've been a big fan of the biting elbows music video, which I didn't even connect till I just looked at the press notes today. But like, I thought oh, he must have watched that.
He did. I watched that a bunch of times. You got it right.
He took the same crew.
He took that idea. I've seen this before. Jamal Finkley, Blacktree TV. What an intense movie. I mean, I love how technology is like bleeding into the filmmaking process, and we're making films today that we couldn't make 20 years ago if we wanted to.
I'd say 10 years ago.
10 years ago. Five. I mean, five.
No, five we could have probably. First GoPros were on that. Sorry to interrupt. Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, even with the first GoPro had limited, and you was with the GoPro 3.
Three.
Yeah, so first, I know as a director, like just plotting shots. You got to get the lighting right, everything else. How difficult is it when you have the body moving with your camera and it's not all plotted because
it's so plotted.
It's
we blocked it out. We saw, in terms of lightning, to answer that part of it, we made all the sets 360 lightning, so we didn't have setup. We could always, I always wanted to be able to turn anywhere I wanted. Very rarely did we have a flag up or a grip holding something to help us. There were a few occasions, but generally the sets were designed with 360 in mind, practical
totally
lightning.
Lit.
And outside, we didn't use any lightning as outside. We just went and hoped that the sun would not screw us and change directions too much and the rain wouldn't come. Of course it did, but you know.
Yeah.
Who's remembering the negatives?
And Sharlto, you've been a part of Elysium and District 9 and Chappie, which all kind of deal with technology and everything. Is this just from the South African film market? Is this something that's more big on these technology type of films? Or, I mean, like, what brought the attraction to this project?
I mean, the attraction to this in a lot of ways was I saw that a Bad Motherfucker music video, which he'd made, and it blew my mind. I was watching it on repeat like 25 times. The producer of the movie had sent it to me, said, we want to try and make a movie like this.
Yeah.
And in a lot of ways, it reminded me of what we had done with District 9. Literally not since then have I had an opportunity to be as collaborative as well with the director as I was with Ilya on this. It's kind of like, you know, you had this new generation of Russians growing up with this international pop culture media, you know, exposed to it for the first time. Same as we were as South Africans. You know, suddenly you've got, you know, the first generation growing up with this new media. And they have sort of an unusual, just a slightly different take on it. You know, it's like, wow, there's just a little edge there, man. It's what's the edge? There's an edge. There's an edge on this. And so I wanted to go and be a part of trying to make something different.
Film history. Sorry. Part of film history. That's what I was saying.
Speaking of the producer, I know Tamir, in Wanted, you kind of got some shots that were kind of, with the bullets that were kind of like what the GoPro shots would eventually do, a POV. What inspired the Bad Motherfucker video? Like what, we know this, the video inspired this film in a way, but
where
did that come from?
There was a video before that in 2011. So Bad Motherfucker was 2013. 2011, I did a video called The Stampede, which was, it's the direct prequel. Bad Motherfucker picks up exactly where The Stampede ends. And before that, I just bought a camera in Italy. I was snowboarding, and I sucked at snowboarding and gave the camera away, not to be embarrassed anymore. My friend, who's a parkour guy, he shot some basic stuff, gave it back to me. I looked at the material, and I said, I called him up, to Sergey, let's go make a music video. Let's get $300, buy some pizzas, get some friends to fall down the stairs, pay them slices for each take they do. And that's pretty much what happened. I have great friends, I'm very lucky. And it went from there. The first one got like a million views. And I was doing music videos before for my band and spending a lot more money, a lot more effort. Not a lot more effort, but a lot more money. And you get 30,000 views, 40,000, which is great for an unknown punk band from Russia. Mm-hmm. But I was like, well, I know I can do better and the music's better than this. And you know, we didn't have a label or anything. So we just kind of, the Stampede got a couple million, and I was like, oh, I like that, let's do that again. And then it took us, you know, a year and a half of planning just to figure it all out.
Yeah.
And then we released it, and then boom, everything happens like that. So
a year and a half for a 4 to 5 minute music video. How much planning did this take for this feature length film?
It was one of the most, sorry to interrupt, one of the most complicated things was I had to write the script without, and pre-plan the whole film at the same time. You usually get the script, and you sign off on the script, and you start pre-production. But I had to write the script while doing pre-production, while making sure that Sharlto was excited enough by the script that I will write, because he said he's interested, but he's got to see what it is. So also coming up with the concept of the Jimmies that I needed to lure him into this thing. So it was a very tense time. A lot of planning. Mm-hmm. But then again, when you get on the stage, there's a lot of trial error. Half the things that you'd imagine would work and look good, you test it, it looks okay, but you get to the set, it's not that great. The blocking with the actors have to be, we screwed around a lot with the dialogue. We made things, you know, try to go things funnier. I'm a big fan of letting actors do their thing, and then that's why you get someone like Sharlto, because you know he's got a fantastic imagination. He's on it, and he loves to spitball ideas, and we go back and forth. And you know, a lot of input and like a true collaboration. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was very lucky to have Sharlto and not an actor who would show up and be like, I got the lines, I'm done. It was great because that, you know, I got the best of both worlds. I got a great performer and a person who shared his great ideas with me. And you know, you have to be an idiot not to soak up other people's great ideas. That's, I think, part of the being a director is you get the best people you can get, and then you don't just be like, do this, do that, do that, do that. There's a like a despotic way of making a movie, and that sometimes works. But with me, I always understand that there's these great people who have talent, and you listen to them, and you filter, you take the best things, and you get that. And you know, Sharlto gave me so much to choose from. Options, options, options all the time. It was, you know, phenomenal.
It's all right. I'm not here to hurt you. Is your speech module installed? Shit. Yeah. Well, at least we know you're not deaf. It's all right, you can put your hands down now.
3 years I've been waiting for this moment. I'll get Charlie Chaplin.
Right, let's have a look at you. Open the glove box, please. Take out that whole contraption. You've got to untangle the wires. Take your shirt off, please. Open up there. Yeah, those. Plug the jacks in there. Yeah, in there. So, your name's Henry. And, okay, well, the good news is that you're going to live a while. The bad news is that in this case, a while means 20, 30 minutes tops, Henry. Unless you're very, very lucky. There's some clothes in there, put the hoodie on. There's not enough time. If I could just cover the blood up with your back. Just stay calm, and I'm here, man, this here.
Я готов понести наказание.
From the script standpoint, when you was able to read the script, I mean, so much of this thing is so visual from the action sequences. Were you able to see how some of these things would look just from the story, or like?
I mean, I had a sense, some of the fun stuff, like, you know, it's the first time I've ever read a script that's written in the first person. It goes, I walk into the room, I see a mercenary, he shoots at me, I dive out of the, you know.
Yeah.
But it was so organic how this thing was coming together, you know. I knew that when I jumped on. I was like, this is going to be like going back to my filmmaker roots. You got no money, you got a young, passionate team who are going to just, you know, kill themselves or not, as in the case. I mean, there was actually this was the most dangerous film I've ever done as well. So practically, you know, I went in knowing this is going to be a learning curve.
Yeah.
This is going to be constant trial and error to try to see if we can make this thing work.
Is that frustrating from an actor? I mean, I know you coming into it from the beginning and being on as a producer that you was already bought in, but just as an actor, do you think that process is frustrating? From the traditional sense of, this is what the shot's gonna be. We just gotta get the rise right.
I liked it. I mean, I loved obviously the opportunity to play the different versions of Jimmy here was an enormous amount of fun. I like coming up with stuff on the fly. I like the challenge of, you know, we would go in the day, we'd work a scene out, we'd block it, we'd play with it, and then once we had it nailed down, then we'd start trying to hit all the right beats. It was just pushing everybody, man. Just pushing everybody to be at the top of their game. I mean, you give a stuntman a GoPro, you know, stunt guys are used to like being very disciplined about, I'm going to get set on fire, I'm going to jump out the window. He gets zen before he does it. Now he's got a camera on his head. You're like, hey, bro, and, you know, before you go, once you're on fire, just remember to film those guys on fire and then jump out the window. Don't break the GoPro. You know what I mean? Then when you land, remember, once you put yourself out, look back because the other guy on fire is coming out of the thing as well.
And you have two takes to do it. So
you know what I mean?
It was no pressure.
It was enormous pressure and enormous challenge.
So your stuntmen were actually cameramen too, in a way.
There was 12 guys that played Henry, and some of them were more specific. 10 of the guys were like very specific. The guy's on fire, that's one guy. The guy who falls from a helicopter, that's another guy.
And they did it all for real. Every single thing you see. This, you know, the van blowing up under the guy.
There's a guy standing on the van.
Yeah. And lands on the bike. Like,
that's a guy throwing a grenade. There's a fire cannon in there. It sets the fire. He gets yanked up by a crane. The van actually does the flip. It's a proper real van, not a CG van. And he lands on a perfectly bike that is put underneath him. That's, you know.
So the CG enhances, but they were very specific
about
that.
I'm a big fan of proper, you know, it's not so much being a fan, but to make people feel like Henry, for the audience to really connect, I told everybody the way it's going to work is only if it's a real guy shooting that for real.
Yeah.
You know, come hell, high water, we're going to stick to that, and we did. Not a single shot in the film is not a guy doing what he's,
and
what you're saying.
The attempt was to make an immersive experience at the cinema.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was also what was attractive to me. I was like, you know what, let's try to give people a reason to go to the cinema,
yeah,
and actually even have a social experience, you know? So we try to make something that's sort of a cross between
a
movie, a theme park ride, a video game, and like going to a rock concert, you know,
yeah,
if you do it with
social,
your friends.
The social part
social
is great.
Aspect.
It's like when you're like, oh shit, that happened. It's fantastic when there's five of you. You can share that on the spot.
Like, yeah, those oh my God moments of like, are you kidding me? And,
yeah,
and then it's also like, they really did that too? Like,
yeah,
how, you know, it's just
we
fun.
We really did.
It's
yeah,
to try to make a fun experience.
And director, like we've seen this work in action and in music videos, where else can you see like this GoPro POV style of shooting work? You think it could go in sports or anything else? That,
but here's the thing, if someone came up to me now and said we want to see a really sad drama made in POV, I'd be like no, and a week later I'd be like, you know what, yeah, it's just a question of sitting down and figure out it can be used anywhere.
Mm.
I mean, sports, I think, would be fine. Sooner or later, when the camera's going to be tiny, can you imagine having a boxing match where you're going to be seeing it from the perspective of a boxer?
Yeah.
It's going to be a little complicated because those guys are not going to be worrying about how it looks like we
yeah,
had to.
Yeah.
But just this, you know, couple of shots here and there, the possibilities are endless. It's amazing to be able to see through somebody else's eyes
and
live through someone else.
It's and certainly going into like virtual reality.
Yeah.
That's the future
this
right there.
This is, to me, this is some bridge.
Yeah.